And the text of the verse is, Christ wants to be our consolation, Lord, have mercy. The next verse is a little more quizzical, and there's a very short but clear delineation between the verses. If he were not risen, then the world would be lost. Since he is risen, praise the Father, Jesus Christ, Lord, have mercy. You will know when you hear the third verse, because this is where Bach really lets his hair or his wig down. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. We should all be joyful at this. Christ wants to be a consolation. Lord, have mercy. And you can really hear the exaltation in that. And then William Byrd. If you come on a Thursday lunchtime, you will hear the excellent choir singing here at St. Stephen's Warbrook at the lunchtime Eucharist. Byrd will be, or his choral music will be, the backbone of a lot of the repertoire that they sing. And yet, in his 400th anniversary of his death, we are only just rediscovering a lot of his keyboard work, which is glorious, absolutely glorious. This very unpromising start of a single one octave C major scale, albeit with a trill, I think the trill is important, is almost like grade one piano exam. And from this unfolds myriad scales, invention, harmonic turn. It ends up in A major, which has no place in the piece in C major, quite frankly. And it's wonderful. It is quite unlike his choral music. Until you get to the last two bars, where metaphorically he leaves his DNA at the crime scene. You know the Byrd four-part and the five-part mass of those wonderful anthems. Only one person could have written those last two bars, and it's William Byrd, and they are glorious. The whole work is glorious, but particularly the end. I said when I says glorious at the end, that makes it sound like bagpipes, but I don't mean it like that. And then Louis Vierre, his six symphonies. What one needs to understand with the six symphonies is Vierre's mental health. This is important. The first two were written when he was exceedingly confident. Yes, he'd arrived from Perth. He'd won all the prizes in performance and composition at the Paris Conservatoire. Not only had he just been made Beadle's assistant at Sounds of the Peace, that famous church in Paris, he'd then been made organist, titulaire, head organist of Notre Dame when he wrote the first and second symphonies. Life was going brilliantly. And then from about 1905, a series of disasters. He lost a child, a brother. He found out that the surviving child was not his. Tragically, the product of a long-running affair between his best friend and his wife. His sight deteriorated still further. He had to be locked away, essentially, in a pitch-black room with not so much as a hint of light, not a single photon for 6 months. And his mental health collapsed. You can hear that in the range of the third symphony and the despair of the fourth. Now, why am I telling you this when I'm playing you the sixth symphony? It is important because by 1931, when he wrote this, he writes in his diary that he has finally come to terms with his trials, his tribulations, his anguish, and his woe. And you hear that in this music, this tentative unwinding of this very complex motif, which uses every one of the 12 notes of the chromatic scale, although it still does manage to remain tonal, leads into like a giant reawakening, this huge statement of the theme on the full organ. And it is a really delightful romp, if you like, around the full organ. Great fun. And then you hear this very relaxed, contemplative aria, almost like being in a Parisian jazz cafe. You can almost imagine the ladies with their tortoiseshell cigarette holders. Very relaxed, very beautiful and full of repose. And then, in the scherzo, you hear an old man learning to be silly again. And this scherzo is silly. It sounds just like a Pink Panther, I kid you not. And it dances all over the keyboards and the feet. The theme is chopped up into little bits. At the start of the third movement, the fourth movement rather, the adagio, you wonder if there is going to be a relapse into the melancholy that I've sort of hitherto described. And it pulls itself together by the halfway point, and you hear real prayerfulness and acceptance. And then this last movement, which he wrote on his diary in a French seaside town that's called Monton, you hear the waves lapping against the beach, the wall. Not gently, it is a tour de force. The themes that you've heard throughout the symphony come back one by one with a new one. And if you want to glance an eye in the last three or four pages, torrents of pedal scales in F sharp minor, hammering up and down the pedal board. I think it's a marvellous work. I'm delighted to share it with you today. But before that, Das Lied der Sterne by Johann Sebastian Bach.